स्टूडेंट्स, लेट अस स्टार्ट टॉपिक नंबर 11.6, स्पेसिफिक हीट कैपेसिटी। नाउ स्टूडेंट्स, लेट अस फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड अबाउट हीट कैपेसिटी। सपोज इफ यू हैव टेकन सम सब्सटेंस, दिस सब्सटेंस कैन बी आइदर सॉलिड और लिक्विड। नाउ सपोज heat is supplied to this substance, let delta q is the heat supplied, and due to absorption of heat there is a change in temperature of this substance, let this change in temperature is delta t. So ratio of delta q upon delta t is nothing but it is heat capacity denoted by capital S. So heat capacity is delta Q upon delta T, where delta Q is the heat supplied to the given substance and delta T is the change in the temperature due to absorption of this heat. Now students, heat capacity, it depends on the amount of substance. Means if you take small amount of substance or small quantity of substance, then its heat capacity will be less, and if you take large amount of substance then its heat capacity will be more. Also heat capacity depends on the type of the substance. Means if you take a sphere of copper and if you take a sphere of aluminium, suppose the mass of both these spheres is same, but if you supply equal amount of heat to both these substances, that is one to the copper sphere and the other to the aluminium sphere, then the change in temperature for both will not be equal, it will be different. So it is clear that heat capacity depends on the type of the substance or type of the material also. So students, it is clear that the quantity of heat required to warm, that means to heat a given substance, depends on its mass, its change in temperature, and also the nature of the substance. Nature means type of the substance. Now about specific heat capacity. Symbolically, specific heat capacity is denoted by small s. So specific heat capacity is nothing but it is heat capacity divided by mass of the substance. Now students, we know that heat capacity S is delta Q upon delta T. So in place of S, if we put delta Q upon delta T, mass as it is. So specific heat capacity is delta Q upon M delta T. Now specific heat capacity is the property of the substance or a material. It does not depend on the quantity of the substance. See the word specific heat capacity. So it does not depend on mass of the substance. Simply it depends on the type of the substance. So we can say that this specific heat capacity is the property of the material. Now unit of heat capacity, as the formula is delta Q upon delta T, we know that energy, heat energy, is measured in terms of joule and temperature is measured in terms of Kelvin. So joule per Kelvin, or if you are using the unit degree Celsius, then you can write joule per degree Celsius. But we know that if we want to write the unit of any physical quantity, then we have to use the SI system of unit. So joule per Kelvin, Kelvin is SI unit system for temperature, Celsius is not. So unit of heat capacity is joule per Kelvin. Similarly, unit of specific heat capacity is joule per kg per Kelvin. Mass is measured in terms of kg. So you can see here, unit of specific heat capacity is joule per kg per Kelvin. Now about molar specific heat capacity. Students, in specific heat capacity, we have divided heat capacity by quantity of the substance, that is mass. But in molar specific heat capacity, denoted by capital C, we have to divide the heat capacity of the substance by 1 mole. Mu is nothing but is mole of that substance. So it is heat capacity per mole. Molar specific heat capacity is heat capacity per mole. Now unit of this molar specific heat capacity, you can see from this formula, heat energy, that is delta Q, is measured in terms of joule. Temperature is in Kelvin, so it is Kelvin inverse, and mu is in mole, so mole inverse. So unit of molar specific heat capacity is joule per mole per Kelvin. Now students, molar specific heat capacity can be calculated for constant pressure as well as for constant volume. So if we take any gas under a constant pressure during the heat transfer, suppose the heat transfer is taking place for any given gas at constant pressure, then we can define it as molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure. Here the quantity of gas is taken 1 mole, so it is molar specific heat capacity. So molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure, which is denoted by Cp. Students, remember C is nothing but it is molar specific heat capacity, and here in subscript P is given. That shows that this molar specific heat capacity is at constant pressure. Similarly, if the volume is considered constant for a given gas, if we consider volume to be constant, then we will get molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. Here you can see it is denoted by Cv. This capital C is nothing but is molar specific heat capacity, and this V shows that this molar specific heat capacity is at constant volume. Now students, here in this table 11.3, specific heat capacity of some substances at room temperature and at atmospheric pressure is given. You can see that for aluminium, the specific heat capacity is 900. For water, the specific heat capacity is 4186. So it is clear that the specific heat capacity of water is maximum, and this is the result why water is used as a coolant, because it can absorb more heat. And you can see for different substances the heat capacity, specific heat capacities are given. You can see for solid substances, if we consider only solid substances, then aluminium has the largest specific heat capacity for these given metals. But for liquid, water has the highest specific heat capacity. Students, you might know that in radiators of car or any automobile engine, water is used as a coolant. It is because its specific heat capacity is large. Even for ice, glass, iron, kerosene, oil, mercury, also the specific heat capacity is given here. Now, table number 11.4. In this table, for some gases, molar specific heat capacity is given. You can see that for helium, the molar specific heat at constant pressure is 20.8 and at constant volume is 12.5. Similarly, for hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen and carbon dioxide, the molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure and at constant volumes are given. From this table, it is clear that carbon dioxide has the maximum molar specific heat capacity. Now, about topic number 11.7, calorimetry. Now, students, what do you mean by isolated system? So, here, isolated system is defined. That a system is said to be isolated if there is no exchange or transfer of heat occurs between the system and its surrounding. Means, suppose if I take any metallic cube and if I heat it to raise its temperature. Suppose the temperature of this metallic cube is 45 degrees Celsius. And suppose the surrounding means atmosphere, its temperature is 25 degrees Celsius. In normal situation, we know that there is a heat transfer between this metallic cube and the surrounding. It will take transfer, or heat will transfer from the body having higher temperature to lower temperature. So here definitely this cube has higher temperature than the surrounding. The heat will transfer from this metallic cube to the surrounding and gradually it will cool down. When the temperature of this metallic cube will become 25 degrees Celsius, at that time what will happen? The heat transfer will stop. The net heat transfer will stop between the system, that is this cube, metallic cube, and the surrounding. But suppose if I insulate this cube, Suppose this cube is kept into such a material or such a box where the heat transfer does not take place. So if this metallic cube is kept in such a system or such a box where there is no chance of heat transfer, in that case I can say that the system is isolated. So in such situation, what will happen? The heat will not transfer from this metallic cube to surrounding. So it is clear that isolated system is such system where there is no transfer of heat between the system and the surrounding. Now students, calorimetry. Calorimetry means measurement of heat. We know that if we take two substances, let the first substance is A and the second substance is B, and they were connected with each other so that heat transfer can take place. Now suppose the temperature of this substance A is greater than that of the temperature of substance B, then in that case we know that heat will transfer from A to B. So in that case, what will happen? The amount of heat, that is delta Q, which has been lost by this substance A, will be equal to the amount of the heat gained by the substance B. It is clear that the substance with higher temperature will lose the heat or lose the heat, and that amount of heat will be absorbed by the substance which is at a lower temperature. So here it is written that when a body at higher temperature is brought in contact with another body at lower temperature, heat lost by the hot body is equal to the heat gained by the colder body. So calorimetry means it is measurement of heat. How much amount of heat is absorbed or evolved? Now, to measure the amount of heat either lost or gained by any substance can be done with the help of a device, and that device is known as calorimeter. So a device in which the heat measurement can be done is called a calorimeter. Students, we know that thermometer measures the temperature. Thermometer is used for measuring temperature. Similarly, calorimeter is used to measure the amount of heat. Now, example number 11.3. Students, in this example, it is given that there is a sphere of aluminium, a sphere made up of aluminium whose mass is 0.047 kg. This aluminium sphere is placed for sufficient time in a vessel containing boiling water. The sphere of aluminium is kept in a boiling water, and we know that boiling water has temperature 100 degrees Celsius. So what will happen when this sphere of aluminium is kept inside this boiling water? Even the temperature of this aluminium sphere will become 100 degrees Celsius. Now What happened? This aluminium sphere is now taken out of this boiling water, and then it is immediately transferred to a copper calorimeter containing 0.25 kg water. So this aluminium sphere has temperature now 100 degrees Celsius, and now it is placed inside a water of 0.25 kg, and this water is having temperature 20 degrees Celsius. This water is contained in a copper calorimeter, that is a container made up of copper, and this container is having mass 0.14 kg. So it is clear that the temperature of this water and this copper container, that is copper calorimeter, is 20 degrees Celsius. But when this aluminium sphere, which is having the temperature 100 degrees Celsius, is kept inside this copper container containing this water at 20 degrees Celsius, then the temperature of this water will increase. And suppose here it is given that it is increased to 23 degrees Celsius. So in this case, we have to measure or calculate the specific heat capacity of aluminium. Now students, it is clear that aluminium is at higher temperature, and this water as well as copper calorimeter, they are at lower temperature. So definitely heat transfer will take place from aluminium to this water as well as copper container. And so the temperature of this water and copper calorimeter will raise to 23 degrees Celsius. Now let us understand this example and solve it. So here you can see this is an aluminium sphere whose temperature is 100 degrees Celsius because it was kept first in boiling water. Now this aluminium sphere is placed inside this copper calorimeter containing water. Students, here for aluminium I have denoted number 1. Number 1 means it is aluminium. Number 2 means it is water. And number 3 is for copper. So now mass of this aluminium, that is M1, is given 0.047 kg. Its temperature, that is T1, is 100 degrees Celsius. Water, denoted by number 2, so its temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. Its mass is 0.25 kg. And this copper calorimeter is denoted by number 3. Its mass M3 is 0.14 kg. Also, the specific heat capacity for this water as well as this copper calorimeter is given. Now, when this aluminium sphere is kept inside this container, copper container containing water, what happened? The mixture has a temperature of 23 degrees Celsius after some time. So it is clear that the temperature, the change in temperature of water, initially it was 20 degrees Celsius, now it become 23 degrees Celsius. So change in temperature of water as well as the copper calorimeter is 3 degree Celsius. You can see this difference, 20 and 23. So we can get the change in temperature of this water as well as the copper calorimeter. Also, the aluminium sphere, which was at 100 degree Celsius, now its temperature, final temperature of this mixture is 23 degree Celsius. So the temperature of aluminium sphere becomes 23 degree Celsius. So what is the change in temperature of this aluminium sphere? So it is 100 minus 23, so it is 77 degree Celsius. It is divided by delta T1. So now we need to find the specific heat capacity of aluminium. So for that we will start with this condition that the heat lost by the aluminium sphere, whatever heat is lost by the aluminium sphere, is equal to the heat gained by water and the copper calorimeter. Now heat lost by the aluminium is divided by Q1. So Q1 is equal to heat gained by water and copper calorimeter. So Q1 is equal to Q2 plus Q3. Now students, we have this formula that specific heat capacity, that is small s, is equal to delta Q upon m delta T. This formula we have. So what is delta Q? It is S into m delta T. We can make the subject delta Q. So if we make the delta Q subject, that is heat transfer, delta Q is equal to small s m delta T. So here in place of this Q1, say students, delta Q or simply Q, we can write Q also. So here we have written Q only. So Q1 for aluminium can be written as S1 M1 delta T1. You can see this formula. So this formula is applied here for aluminium. Similarly for Q2, this 2 is for water. So heat absorbed by water, Q2 is S2 M2 delta T2. Similarly Q3 can be written as S3 M3 delta T3. Now specific heat capacity of aluminium is to be find out. So this is question mark. Mass of aluminium is given, change in temperature of aluminium is known to us. So students, here only this, in this equation only this S1 is unknown. M1 is given to us, delta T we have already obtained, S2, M2, delta T2. So these all values are known to us now. You can see here all these values are known to us. Only this S1 is unknown, which is the specific heat capacity of aluminium. So just put these given values and calculate, we will get S1. I have kept here these values and there is a simple calculation. So after calculating it, we can easily get value of S1, that is specific heat capacity of aluminium. Students, calculation part I left up to you. It is quite simple, so try it and obtain this answer. Now students, here this value 912.34 is in joule per kg per Kelvin. But if we shift this decimal point here, then we can write that as kilojoule per kg per Kelvin, because we know that this 912 can be written as 0.912 into 10 raised to 3, and 10 raised to 3 means it is kilo. So specific heat capacity of aluminum is obtained to be 0.912 kilojoule per Kelvin. Here there is a correction, make it 0.912. If you write this answer, then also it is correct. So students, I hope you understood about this example. If you have any doubt, then you can ask me.